CFM International, a Franco-American engine manufacturer, was launched as a joint venture between two of the world's largest engine makers, General Electric, or GE Aerospace, and Safran Aircraft Engines. Founded in 1974, the manufacturer has continued to build turbofan engines for 50 years and remains the largest commercial aircraft engine builder worldwide, making around 40% of the world's engines in 2020. Today's video will take a look at the roots of this long-standing partnership and how CFM engines have gone to power many of the world's commercial aircraft. Today, the company remains headquartered in Cincinnati, Ohio, with the original purpose of building and supporting the CFM56 turbofan engine series. As of 2024, the company continues to produce some of the most advanced and popular engines on the market today, having delivered over 37,500 power plants to more than 570 operators. The original name of the joint venture, CFM, finds its origins in the naming schemes that the two companies had for commercial engines, GE's CF series and Snecma's M series. While there have been other partnerships, such as GE and Pratt & Whitney collaborating as Engine Alliance, there are few that have achieved the level of sustained success enjoyed by CFM. As mentioned earlier, General Electric and Snecma, the precursor to today's Safran, initially collaborated on the development of the CFM56 engine, which would ultimately become a major development in the history of engine making. This engine would go on to be the principal power plant for the Boeing 737 and Airbus A320 families, with both aircraft types themselves absolutely dominating the short and mid-range air travel market. CFM56 would go on to become the best-selling and most widely used commercial turbofan engine of all time. The collaboration on this engine, however, came somewhat out of left field. GE had initially focused on producing engines for military aircraft, with its civil sector ambition continuing to grow throughout the 1950s and 1960s. Snecma also had a background in building engines for military jets, but finally began to explore opportunities that might exist in the civil aircraft market. Nonetheless, the French manufacturer had limited experience with high-pressure turbines and high-temperature alloys. Shifts in French governmental policy encouraged Snecma to pursue international collaboration, and the company soon began to seek out a partner for what would become the CFM56 engine project in 1971. Eventually, GE Aerospace was chosen due to the company's technological experience and impressive global reach, with competitors such as Pratt & Whitney and Rolls-Royce appearing to lag. A meeting of major shareholders occurred in April 1970 in Massachusetts, when Snecma and GE agreed to a joint partnership. It was only 4 years later, on January 24, 1974, that a collaboration was officially signed. Why did it take so long? Well, as noted by Aviation Week, one problem was that when GE applied for its export license, the US government essentially said, "No, absolutely not. It's a classified engine. It's military. It's our top secret stuff. There's no way we can let this go outside of the country as a commercial engine." More specifically, the core technology in GE's possession was an aspect of a strategic national defense system, America's B-1 bomber. Negotiations continued at the highest level as companies pushed their nation's politicians to work out a deal. And finally, an agreement was reached in 1973 between the presidents of France and the United States, which would allow the collaboration to go ahead. The new company, CFM International, would be owned equally by the two companies, and it would eventually be incorporated in September 1974. As noted in an old New York Times piece, the agreement was reportedly based on assurances that the core of the engine, the part that GE was developing from the military F-101, would be built in the US and then transported to France in order to protect the sensitive technologies. Being a joint venture between two companies, the newly formed CFM International had amassed a large amount of capital, and production responsibilities were shared between the two parent manufacturers. This partnership allowed both companies to leverage their strengths to reduce production costs and expand their global reach. But it's crazy to think that CFM International was almost disbanded and dissolved. That's because once the CFM56 hit the market, it actually wasn't that well received. As noted in an Aviation Week podcast, it was expected that everybody would come beating a path to CFM's doors, but they didn't. That was the problem. Unfortunately, it was a difficult time in the industry. The engine type actually failed to receive an order during its first 5 years on the market. An article published at the time from a French newspaper called Le Canard Enchaîné chronicled CFM's troubles, with the title of the piece being The Misfortune of an Unsellable Engine. At a meeting in April of 1979, there was one agenda between GE and Safran: to shelve the joint venture. However, literally 2 weeks before this meeting was to take place, CFM finally got an order to re-engine 110 DC-8s operated by a number of airlines. This order essentially saved the partnership and was able to get the ball rolling. The CFM56 achieved far beyond its projected commercial success. Competitors had to begin facing the truth that CFM International was undoubtedly here to stay. Throughout its complex history, the company has only actually been involved with three different engine production programs. First, there is, of course, the CFM56. This was followed up by the Leap. And finally, still in development, is the CFM International Rise. One could hypothetically make an argument that the CFM56 alone could make CFM the most successful aerospace joint venture of all time, especially within the engine space. But there's more to the CFM story, as the Leap has become one of the industry's top engines to propel the newest jets. Designed as a next-generation power plant, the Leap powers the newest variants of the Airbus A320 and Boeing 737 families. It is the exclusive engine of the Boeing 737 MAX family and one of two options for the A320neo family. On the Airbus side, however, the CFM Leap has not faced the same major reliability issues as the competing Pratt & Whitney geared turbofan option. Over time, the Leap has slowly become the core of the manufacturer's product offerings, naturally overtaking demand for the CFM56. At the upper level of CFM Leap models and variants, the Leap 1A is for Airbus A320neo family aircraft, the 1B is for the Boeing 737 MAX family, while the Leap 1C for the Chinese-built Comac C919. Quite interestingly, some experts in the sector suspect that the Leap 1C is more of an upgraded version of the older CFM56 and lacks the same performance as its 1A and 1B siblings. The reason for using second-tier technology may have something to do with guarding intellectual property and technology from being stolen by China's aerospace industry. As reported by Forbes, Richard Abulafia, a consultant with Aerodynamic Advisory, commented, "A supplier would have to be out of their mind to provide the latest and best." But finally, when it comes to CFM as a company, the joint venture continues to press ahead with the development of the CFM Rise engine. Designed to enter service in the mid-2030s, the Rise might just be the most promising attempt to build a next-generation engine designed for sustainable fuels. The power plant will feature an open rotor design and plans to achieve a fuel burn reduction of around 20% in comparison to conventional power plants. It's a work in progress, but clearly CFM has the experience and the credentials to produce yet another popular industry-leading engine. So, what do you think of CFM International, its history, and its achievements? Let us know by leaving a comment. Simple Flying publishes over 150 articles every week. If you're looking for the latest aviation news and insights, visit simpleflying.com.